I have been binging on Neil deGrasse Tyson's Star Talk YouTube channel since I got sick 2 weeks ago. And for those of you who don't know, he's an astrophysicist who is known for taking big, complex, boring topics and making them really easy to understand, really engaging. Of course, as I was binging these, I can't help myself but notice the classic frameworks he uses that we talk about on this channel, we talk about in my course. So I want to break it down for you, the 9 frameworks he used to talk about the three-body problem. Let me show you what I mean.
You're going to get an astrophysicist explanation of the literal three-body problem without reference to anything that's shown up on streaming services.
And that means he's not going to ruin the show for you.
Okay, straight off the bat, do you notice? Number one, he used one of my favorite frameworks, bluff. Bottom line up first. He's telling us what he's going to do, which is he's going to talk about the three-body problem from the physicist point of view, astrophysicist point of view. And then he uses next framework, which is also a crowd favorite, is via negativa. Right? He talks about what he is not going to do, which is talk about the three-body problem, the show, the three-body problem on Netflix. So what we're already seeing, 2 frameworks used in the first, 10 seconds of his talk. So this is about to get good. Let's get back to it.
I don't know anything about the show, but I do know enough to describe the three-body problem to you coming up.
And by the way, I just want to say, Neil deGrasse Tyson, I think he's the perfect intersection of lots of things I care about. Anyone else find them at this intersection where you care about space, frameworks, you know, articulating yourself? Let me know in the comments.
Let's start simple.
Okay.
So as we know, the moon orbits the Earth.
Right.
But that's not the right way to say it.
Okay. All right.
Okay, let's pause here for a second. He's starting simple. This genuinely is one of the hardest things to do. We hear this all the time at work, right? Make your presentation to the point. Make it simpler. Explain it to me in simpler terms. And he shows us how to do this in a few ways. But the third framework, or anywhere on the third one, is he makes the abstract concrete. That is a key skill you need when you want to make things simpler. Because let's just look up, you know, the three-body problem. Already, I'm getting lost in the first sentence. Classical mechanics, quantum mechanics, do I need to know those? And the models, the motion of three particles, like I don't understand what this is saying. I'm questioning, do I even need to know what the three-body problem is? Sounds very far away from me. And then the next one doesn't help either. Hypothetical concepts, so is this not real? And it's in which there are two bodies. I thought this was a three-body problem. Where does the two-body come from? So as you see, abstract ideas very quickly remove our interest, make us feel like, oh, I don't understand this. I don't know what it's talking about. I want to run away from this, using too much of my mental energy. But Neil geniusly uses the framework of taking abstract things and turning them into concrete things, right? He says, here's a moon, here's an Earth, right? We both know what those are. We know how those affect us, and we know how they move. The next framework he uses is starting from the middle. So many of us, when we're doing presentations at work, we're talking and explaining things, we like to start from the very beginning. First, we did this research, right? And here are all of the pieces we found. And then we came to the conclusion, maybe we should focus on this. And then here's more things, and blah, 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 blah. And the listener is losing direction as to, what is the actual problem? What are the things I should care about? What's the priority? Rather, you want to start in the middle. Because see, Neil also doesn't start from when we first discovered gravity. Newton was under a tree, blah, blah, blah. He doesn't go through there. He starts in the middle where there's a problem that's relevant and interesting that he's going to show in a second, which leads me to the next framework he's using here, and that is a three-part framework, and he starts from the first one, which is surprise. He says, the moon orbits the Earth, but that's not the right way of saying it. All of a sudden, you're like, what? I know that to be true. How can it not be the right way of saying it? What am I missing? Right? So you're capturing the attention of the audience with this framework so that you can prime them to take in the information, the new information you're about to give them. All right, let's keep going and see where this goes.
The moon and the Earth orbit their common center of gravity.
Ooh.
So Earth is not just sitting here.
Right, and the moon is going around.
Going around it. They feel in their common center of gravity. You know where it is? It's 1,000 miles beneath Earth's surface, along a line between the center of the Earth and the center of the moon.
All right, here's part 2 of the framework we just saw. We introduced surprise, we caught people's attention. Once we have that attention, we want to introduce the complication. The complication takes a little bit of mental energy to understand, so you want to introduce it once you have everyone's attention. So in Neil's case, it was the moon doesn't actually orbit the Earth, but rather the two of them orbit their center of mass. Now that brings the next framework, which you've got to define and highlight key concepts. What we usually do, the easy pitfall is, here's the topic, you know, let me explain, you need to understand these three things, and then based on those three things, we came to the conclusion. There is no emphasis placed on different things, right? It's just, okay, here's number one, here's number two, here's number three, and it's over. The listener doesn't know where to pay attention. So instead, what you want to do is really highlight the concepts that people don't know. Neil knows right now that most people don't know anything about the center of mass. So he highlights it. He says, we're going to talk about the center of mass. And then he uses the next framework, which is explaining the same concept in four different ways. He uses visuals, audio, text, as well as kinesthetics, which means, right, he talks about first audibly. He talks about the center of mass is 1,000 miles beneath the Earth's surface. And then he has the moving graphics that represent how the moon and the Earth orbits with the center of mass. Then in his hands, he is also moving the globe and the moon. So physically he is doing that. Plus he's got text on his graphics to show you what is the actual relationship, what are the words being used. So when you introduce a new concept, you really have to put the spotlight on it and explain it in a few different ways so more people will have a better chance of understanding what you're talking about. All right, so all of that just happened within the first minute or so. We are already, I think, up to, what are we, framework 7. Right. Let's get back to the video and let me show you a few more things.
So as the moon moves here, that center mass line shifts. Okay.
Mm.
So that means Earth is kind of jiggling like this as the moon goes around.
Gotcha.
That's their center of mass.
Here's framework number 8. Spell out the so what. I've talked about it on this channel before in consulting. One of the core frameworks is so what, so what, so what. You got to dig at least 3 levels deep in order to find some sort of insight and really get to the heart of the problem. What Neil is doing is telling you, okay, so what if the moon and the Earth is orbiting around the center of mass? What does that mean? So what? Right, he says, so this line, center of mass line, moves. And that is really important to spell it out for the other person. Don't wait for them to come to conclusions because they're still learning. They're still processing the new information. So give them the so what. And we saw the co-host, Chuck. He was like, okay. Not sure if he's actually getting it or not. So Neil adds a little personification. Here is where he starts to mix things up a little bit. You know, the Earth jiggles, right? He helps make that concept more memorable. Okay, the Earth is jiggling as the moon is going around it. And this is a really great technique to be able to keep the engagement when you're explaining something a little bit more difficult. So based on all of that explanation, I can now confidently update how I understand how the moon goes around the Earth. That will be really important in understanding the 3-body problem in a second. All right, let's get back to the video.
This is the 2-body problem. It is perfectly solved. Using equations of gravity,
right,
and mechanics.
Makes sense.
Perfectly solved.
Yeah.
Isaac Newton solved it.
Okay.
My boy.
That's your man.
So that worked.
All right, so I don't know which number we're up to. I think we're at 10. Right now we are naming the concept. He's naming this the 2-body problem. Now everything ties in together. I want to give you an aside, which is when you do presentations at work, you can actually choose to name the concept a lot earlier. So this is a very, you know, casual, conversational, entertaining video. So he does it later, which helps build up the excitement, a great technique. But when you're at work, you might want to be more direct, in which case you would introduce the 3-body problem. The first thing we're going to talk about to understand the 3-body problem is with the 2-body problem. And then you go into the details of here's a moon, here's the Earth, blah, blah, blah. And that would, if those of you who have attended my course or have some experience with frameworks, you'll see that is the setup for the pyramid principle, right? You have the first answer, you have some supporting arguments, and then you go into the details. Now, let's come back to the 3rd part of the framework that started with surprise. Remember, we talked about surprise, we talked about complication, and at the end comes the resolution. And here we got the resolution, which is the 2-body problem is perfectly solvable by Newton's equations, right? So we understand, okay, even though it was complicated, we have a resolution. So that really closes one loop of here's something surprising, here's a complication, we learn some new concepts here, and now we have the resolution. But as you'll see going forward, he's going to open up new loops which will continue to keep our attention and learn new things. Now we've only done probably a minute of this video, but there is a meta framework at work which is called scaffolding. I think we've already gone beyond the 9 or 10 I said I would go through, so call this a bonus one. And this is when you take the big concept, you break it down into pieces, and you start with something that the audience already knows. And that makes it so much easier to then build on the scaffolding. So in Neil's case, for example, 3-body problem, most people watching the video don't know anything about. 2-body problem, most people in the audience doesn't know anything about. So he starts with the moon and the Earth, right? Something that we all know at least a little bit about. And then he starts to build up. Okay, they orbit each other, and there's some sort of gravity. But then he updates your knowledge, right? He says, okay, here's the center of mass. So you're building onto ideas, starting with something you already know. It's the same thing when he evokes Newton, right? So we've talked about the two-body problem. We know it has to do with stars and how they orbit each other. As soon as he introduces Newton, we realize, ah, this is related to gravity, the apple falling on Newton's head, and then he came up with some equations. Right, so now he's bringing, here's some space elements, here's some gravity elements, here's some motion elements, and now we're starting to hook this new information onto things we already know, which will help us understand more new information. With that, let's get back to the video because there's actually a few more things I want to point out.
Then Isaac applied the equations to the Earth-Moon system going around the Sun.
Okay.
That worked too. So in that system, let's ignore the moon for the moment. It's Earth going around. It's another two-body system.
Notice Neil almost went into explain some details that he didn't need to. He was saying, okay, Newton, two-body problem, it worked. Now he's applying it to the moon, the Earth, and the Sun. And so a lot of us will be thinking, oh, here's the three-body problem now. But then Neil says, no, actually, you know, if you ignore the moon, it's actually a two-body problem. It works perfectly fine. So what he did here was consciously remove going into a detail that is important, but not important for this discussion. You might face similar situations when you present, right? You're presenting and you end up wanting to explain a small nuance that is important, but not necessary to understand the main point of the discussion. What you can do is, even if you found yourself starting to talk about it, you can skip over it. Because every time when we present something, when we explain something, time is limited and there's one point that is waiting to be explained. So we want to do the best we can to focus on the main point. And always, you know, if someone else has the question about the nuance that you started to introduce, you can always talk about it later, right? Take it offline, answer it in the question and answer period that is away from the main point. So this way, making that delineation is important.
But then he worried. He said, every time Earth comes around the back stretch and Jupiter's out there.
Right.
Jupiter, but tug on it a little bit.
That's a lot of gravity.
A little bit, tug on it. As we come around back the other side.
What's up, Earth?
All right. And then he comes around again, tugs on it again.
What's up, Earth?
Right. And of course, everybody's moving in the same direction around the Sun. So the Earth would have to go a little farther in its orbit to be aligned again with Jupiter.
Right.
But it's going to tug on it. Okay.
You see what he's doing here? He is adding a surprise. We're opening up a new SCR, surprise complication resolution loop here. Yeah, everything is working out fine, except Jupiter is around and it's tugging on the Earth. All right, now we're engaged again. What is happening here? What's going to happen? So let's see what happens.
He looked at all these little tugs and he says, I'm worried that the solar system will go unstable.
Right.
Because if it keeps tugging on it, it keeps pulling it away. And the previously stable orbit would just decay into chaos.
Okay.
He was worried about this.
Okay.
You know what he said? But I know my stuff works, and it looks stable to me.
Right.
So clearly it is stable, even though it looks like maybe it wouldn't be stable.
All right, so here we just had a surprise, and the complication is, if that keeps on happening, there will be chaos. And Newton knows about this, right? And our problem-solving brain is like, ooh, so what is it? What is it, right? That is priming us to introduce the key concept that's about to come.
She said, every now and then, God fixes things.
Well, there you go.
That's the answer.
Even Isaac Newton. Wow, look at that.
Yep.
When in doubt.
When in doubt.
Just let God figure it out.
Right. I can't figure it out.
God did it.
Clearly, we're all still here, and we haven't been yanked out of orbit by Jupiter.
Right.
But Jupiter is pulling on us.
So it's a God correction.
God correction.
All right, so here's the resolution, right? What's fitting in here is a God correction. That was Newton's answer. So that's a closing of the SCR loop, except Neil's going to do something different this time. He's going to offer us a different resolution. So let's see what happens here.
This is the first hint that a third body is messing with you.
Right.
Okay? In some way that maybe is harder to understand.
Mm-hmm.
Fast forward 113 years.
All right.
We get to Laplace. He studied this problem.
Right.
Okay? And he developed, I don't think he invented, but he developed a new branch of calculus.
Ooh.
Called perturbation theory.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Okay? Unknown to Newton, even though Newton invented calculus.
Right.
He invented calculus.
Right.
All right? So he could have done it. He could have said, in order to solve this problem, let me invent
more calculus.
I just need more calculus. He didn't do it.
Mm.
Didn't do it.
All right, here we're getting another key concept. Remember, we got one resolution. and that's God's correction, but we think there's another one. So let's come back to the complication, which is, why is there tugging, but the solar system seems to be stable? And he's saying, here's perturbation theory. Let's talk about what it is. And again, because it takes more mental strength to focus on this, what he does is use a little personification again. Right here, let me capture everyone's attention again. Here, you know, Newton is the inventor of calculus, but why didn't he come up with this one? Adds a little bit of humor so that we focus on what's about to come.
Laplace develops perturbation theory, and it comes down to, we have two bodies, the sun and the earth in this case, and the third one, the tug is small, but it's repeating. Mm-hmm. It's not a big tug. Jupiter's not sitting right here.
Right. It's way out there.
Way out there. It's just a little tug. And so you can run the equations in such a way and realize that a two-body system that is tugged often by something small, that it all cancels out in the end.
Gotcha.
All right, here we have that resolution again. With perturbation theory, what we understand is with a two-body and something far away, then everything cancels out. So everything we've learned up to this point brought us to the understanding of perturbation theory without any complicated jargon that we had to go through. So I want to pause here, even though there's a lot more to the video and you can check that out. But let's reflect back on what helps break something down, make something a little bit simpler to talk about. Number one is, we can't hold on to every single detail. We have to let things go. Let's start from the middle, where there's an actual interesting problem, where there's a surprise, where there's a complication, so that we can get people's attention and get them to be primed to understand the new information, the key concepts that we're going to introduce. Then it's about defining those moments where you're going to introduce the new information. Remember, we start with the things that we already know with scaffolding, and then we're going to highlight and emphasize the key concepts. In Neil's case, it was center of mass as well as perturbation theory and how they relate to each other. And finally, you have to build up. I talked about it in this video as well. Everyone wants to be really brief, right? Everyone wants to use as little words as possible, but actually you need to use as many words as possible to get your message across. So in Neil's case, it was, in order to explain the three-body problem, you gotta first explain the two-body problem first in order for everyone to understand how to even get there. So don't worry about losing all the word count and being as to the point as possible. You also have to think about, how can you build up the story so that people actually can follow along with you. Making something simple is not that easy, but luckily you've got this channel, you've got frameworks. I talk about more frameworks to simplify what you're saying in this video, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!